First and foremost, it's my unique, humble opportunity to be here with you in this prestigious masjid. And I want to say Jazakumullah khairan for the invitation. And hopefully, inshallah ta'ala, with this very short amount of time, I want to give you a gift. A gift that inshallah ta'ala can change all of us. Because it changed me as a human being. It changed me as a Muslim. It changed me as a father. It changed me as a husband. It changed me as a son. And it made me realize who I really was in life. And it was the greatest ni'mah I think I've ever been given after being guided to Islam 15 years ago, alhamdulillah. There was a question being proposed throughout the world during a time when the Prophet was being ridiculed, was being mocked. And it's proceeded and gotten even worse today. But the question for us became, man huwa Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Who is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Who is he for the world? Who is he? How do we define such a great man in a context that can benefit people in 2013? Because if we cannot do this, if we cannot understand who is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam in a way that benefits humanity in 2013, then wallahi we have not understood Muhammad Rasulullah. We've not understood the second half of the Shahadatain. I want to give you 4 points today, insha'Allah ta'ala, that are a compendium, a comprehensive idea of who Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was for the world. And for any of us who say we want to follow the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salat wasalam, which is wajib, it's wajib to follow the sunnah. Atiullah wa atiur rasul, it's wajib to follow the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salat wasalam. But we cannot say we follow the sunnah if our entirety of sunnah is lifting up our pants, siwak, eating with the right hand, sleep. This is not the entire idea of the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So we'll discuss 4 things today, insha'Allah ta'ala. 4 things out of the life of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam by with which I will get, think you will get my point. And all of these stories I'm going to tell you like a story because they're well known. These stories are known to be authentic. You know where you can find them. I don't need to give you book, title, reference, author, etc. 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 And I hope that my horrible English accent, American English, Southern English, to make it even worse, it benefits you and you're able to follow along with me, insha'Allah ta'ala. Let's begin at the beginning, due to time's sake. When the Prophet alayhi salat wasalam was 40 years old, and he was retired into Ghar al-Hira, the cave of Hira, in Jabr al-Nur, the mountain of light. When he was in this cave, which is not really, for those of you who have been, it's not much of a cave, as more as it's just a concave inside of the mountain where it's just enough room for you really to sit. When he was sitting there, he said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that all of a sudden, a figure appeared to me. And what was he doing? The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was sitting there, looking at his people, watching them go about their daily affairs, and wondering, what can I do to change my people? They are in the steeps of ignorance. They are in the worst degradation. They don't treat human beings the way they should be treated. Women are property. We bury children in the ground. We cheat each other. We don't do anything that is of any benefit to humanity. How can I, as one human being, fix any of this? And at this point, a figure appeared to him in the cave. And this figure, this person, only had one thing to say to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, Iqara, read, recite. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam responded, I don't know how. I don't know what you want me to recite. So then this figure squeezed him till it hurt him. And then said to him, Iqara. He said again, I don't know. I have no idea what it is that you want me to recite, nor do I even know how. He squeezed him again. And he told him these powerful words, Iqara bismi rabbika ladhi khalaqa. Read in the name of your Lord who created you. Created you from a congealed drop of blood. Read in your Lord is most bounteous. He taught that to man by the use of the pen, that which he did not know. Subhanallah. This would become the initiation of Allah's final revelation to humanity. After all of this time that has passed since Adam alayhi salam, Allah decided finally to initiate His last and final revelation and words to humanity upon the Prophet alayhi salat wa salam. Now, Jibril alayhi salam also introduced himself. He said, Ana Jibril, I am Gabriel. I am the messenger from Allah to the messengers of Allah. This is my job. He introduced Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to his Rabb. He said, your Rabb is Allah, who has created you to worship Him with Tawheed, with oneness, with unique oneness. Single out all your ibadahs solely for Him. Then Jibril alayhi salam introduced Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to himself. He said, and you, O Muhammad, have been chosen by Allah to be His last and final messenger to humanity. And then, the same way Jibril alayhi salam came, he left. He dropped this weight on the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and then left. This weight was so heavy, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam felt it. This is a weight that is so heavy, Allah says in Surah Al-Hashr, that had we revealed this Quran into a mountain, you would have seen that mountain just crumble out of khashya for Allah Azza wa Jal. This was a heavy weight that was sitting on the shoulders of Abdullah bin Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam. So what was he going to do? He decided to go home to his wife Khadija radiallahu anha. The person to whom was his comfort in this life, his consort in this life, Khadija radiallahu anha, a woman whom he loved so much that even long after her death she used to make women jealous. Subhanallah. We say about radiallahu anhu wa radiallahu anha wa ardaha. May Allah grant her the highest ranks of Jannah and be eternally pleased with her, because she was the comfort of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He went home to Khadija radiallahu anha and he told her what happened. And he asked her, have I gone crazy? Have I lost my mind? She said to him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you are not someone whom Allah would inflict with madness. You are someone who stands up for justice. You take care of the poor. You pass no one without a smile. You help everyone you can. You are known as Al-Amin amongst your people. This is not something that Allah would inflict you with insanity. So not only did she affirm him, she believed in him. She became the first of the first to believe in him, as he said to Aisha radiallahu anha one day when she got jealous that the Prophet was crying about Khadija. He said, are you still crying over this old woman? He said, this woman supported me when no one else supported me. She believed in me when no one else believed in me. There's no woman like her. Radiallahu anha wa radaha. So she believed in him. But then she wanted some confirmation. So she went to one of her relatives, Waraqa bin Nawfal radiallahu anhu, and she told him what had happened. And he was someone who was in tune with the former revelations of Allah as they were existing in that time, in their debilitated states. He had read the Torah as it was at that time, even after it had been corrupted. He had read the Injil as it was at that time, even though it's gone through its corruption stages. But when Khadija radiallahu anha told him what happened to her husband, he said, by Allah, your husband has been visited by the same angel that visited Musa, the same angel that visited Isa. This is Jibreel, and he only comes to the messengers of Allah, and your husband is well known to us. Anyone who knows the former revelations from Allah, your husband is well known to us. Then Waraqa radiallahu anhu met the Prophet some time later, and he gave him some very, very ominous news. And he was old and become blind at this time. He told the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, I wish I was a young man. I wish I was a young man so that I could be with you to support you when your people throw you out. Now, you have to understand the asabiyyah of the Arabs at this time. Unfortunately, this same asabiyyah has come to infect our ummah again. It has come to destroy us once again. And this is what the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, I worry nothing after me for you more than asabiyyah, more than racism, more than tribalism. That the Arabs would support one another, family members, even in blatant wrong. Even if they knew they were wrong. Even if they knew what they were doing was wrong, they would still support the family. This Italian mafioso type of mentality that you never betray the family, you never turn on the family. He said, will my own people throw me out for this one simple message? I want from them one word, ahad. Will they throw me out for this? Waraqa said, have no doubt about that fact. No one came with what you are coming with, except that their own people were the first ones to throw them out. So he gave him some very ominous news. Now, the Prophet ﷺ said, after this initial revelation of Iqra bismi rabbika aladhi khalaqa, nothing else came. Jibreel didn't visit him anymore. No more surah were revealed. Nothing happened. He was left just to contemplate this message, this mission, these words. And so much so that one day it bothered him. He didn't know what am I supposed to do now? So he got up and went and walked in the desert. He walked outside of the city of Mecca and decided to go walk in the desert. And all of a sudden Jibreel ﷺ appeared again, standing across the sky, and said to him, I am Jibreel, and you are indeed the messenger of Allah. Don't have any doubt about that fact. It wasn't a vision, a dream, a hallucination. This is real. So much so the Prophet ﷺ said that Jibreel frightened me the way he appeared to me. So he ran home to his wife Khadija radiallahu anha and told her, Dhamiluni, wrap me up. So she covered him up in a blanket. Now, in this state of being wrapped up, Remember, the Prophet ﷺ only has Iqra bismi rabbika ladhi khalaqa and the few verses after that. He only knows who Jibreel is, he knows who Allah is, and he knows who he's supposed to be. But that's it. But in this state, Allah Azza wa Jal reveals to him, Ya ayyuha al-mudathir, qum fa'andir. O you who is wrapped up in that mantle, get up and go warn the people about me. Warabbaka fakabbir, and magnify your Lord and purify your garments and stay away from the idols. Subhanallah. Now Allah Azza wa Jal is telling him, there's no more time for sitting around. You know who I am. You know who you are. You know about the people and their evil and their wickedness. Go out and warn them about me. Qum fa'andir. Go warn them. And what did the Prophet ﷺ do? He threw off that blanket and he got up and he began the job that he would do to the last day of his life, which was Qum fa'andir. That weight, that verse became a burden on the shoulders of our beloved Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That verse kept him up at night. That verse kept him out in the day. That verse caused him to go through so much hardship, so much difficulty, so much retribution, so much pain. That verse caused him, but it became whom he was. If you wanted to ask me, man huwa Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I'll tell you, qum fa'andhir. That's who he was. He was a man who lived a life of qum fa'andhir. He got up, which means action, and he went out and he warned people that there will come a day where you're going to answer to Allah for what you have done. There will come a day where you will stand in front of Allah. Actually, you might not be even able to stand. Because as the Prophet ﷺ says, we will be like a newborn calf on that day. Our legs won't even support us when we're in front of Allah. We won't even be able to stand. But there's going to come a day where you're going to stand in front of Allah and He's going to question you for everything that you have done. That was a simple message. Believe in Allah, worship Him. قُلْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ تُفْلِحُونَ. I promise you that you'll have success. Whether you're the first or the last, you will enter into Jannah. خلاص. This was his message to humanity. And for the next 23 years of his life, he sallallahu alayhi wasallam lived this message. He lived it. He spent every single day trying to bring someone else to this deen. That was it. And that's the entirety. Anything you want to show me from the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ, I will show you it is about qum fa'andhir. Every bit of it. Any part of the sunnan that you want to bring to me, I will show you it is about qum fa'andhir. It is about warning people about Allah. It's about teaching people how to worship Allah Azza wa Jal properly. All of it. The entirety of the Quran and the entirety of the sunnah is about worshiping Allah Azza wa Jal as He should be worshipped. And about sharing that message with someone else. Sharing that message with someone else. Now, if I wanted to end here and say I've done my job, the Prophet ﷺ was qum fa'andhir. He was someone who got up and warned people about Allah. I've done my job. And I think I could prove that we are not living the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ as we should be. Because there's too great of a population of Muslims in Britain for Britain not to be a better place because of us. This is a travesty that we have put forward, is that we've been living here for so long and Britain is not the most pristine country on the planet because of us. Astaghfirullah. May Allah forgive all of us. Because it was the status of the Prophet ﷺ, wherever he put his two feet, he made that place better. It was the status of the companions, radiallahu anhum wa radahum, may Allah be pleased with every one of them, that wherever they planted their two feet, they made that place much better because of their presence. Now, I don't know if we have that same status anymore. Because if so, they wouldn't be trying to kick us out every day. They would be wanting and begging us not to leave them anymore. This was the status of the companions, radiallahu anhum. Wherever they went, the people begged them to not leave us. Please don't leave us. But I want to be thorough, inshallah ta'ala, in the next 10 minutes. So we'll fast forward to two more incidences. I have to skip one for time's sake. It's the story of Ta'if, and all of you know it. Let's fast forward just a little bit. Because we start at the beginning of the seerah, meaning the beginning of the nabuwah of the Prophet ﷺ, the beginning of prophethood. Let's go to the end, the last year. Let's go to the last year. During the last year of the life of the Prophet ﷺ, and this is one of the most important events in his life for us. During the last year of his life, after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah had been signed, allowing the Prophet ﷺ and his companions to make Hajj the following year. So the following year, before Dhul-Hijjah approached, the Prophet ﷺ announced for everyone to prepare yourself for the Hajj. Prepare yourself for the sacred ritual of making Hajj to the house of Allah Azza wa Jal. So the Prophet ﷺ, after 23 years of Qum fa'andhir, He marched with between 120 to 140,000 of his companions, and they marched upon the city of Mecca. And they performed the sacred rites of Hajj. And this hadith that I'm going to tell you now is actually the most authentic narration we have from the Prophet ﷺ, recorded by the most companions in the most beautiful chains of narration. And the one that I'm, the longest version of it is narrated in the Musnad by Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu an. Epitome of manhood, Umar, mashaAllah. But nevertheless, the Umar said, after the day of Arafah, Yawm al-Arafah. For those of you who have made Hajj, you know that Hajj is all about Arafah. Arafah is also known as Yawm al-Hajj. This is the day of Hajj. Why? Because everything else you've done during Hajj is to lead you to that place. Why? Because this is as close as you're going to get in this life to knowing what it'll be like to stand in front of Allah Azza wa Jalla on the day of judgment. And you only spend from Fajr till just after Asr, when you start marching again, if you do it properly, standing under the blazing sun, half naked, doing one thing all day long. And that's making dua. Making dua for you. Remember to make dua for people you've forgotten your whole life. But one thing you've become very, very selfish with on that day is your own dua for Allah to forgive you. That's what you make dua for on that day. That's this beautiful day where you make dua for Allah to forgive you. Because we know the Prophet ﷺ said that Allah descends to the lower heavens in a manner that befits His majesty on this day. And He asked the inhabitants of that heaven, who are these people? They've come naked and dirty. They're tired. They're crying. What do they want? As Allah already knows. But the angels respond, Ya Allah, they've come here to ask you. They've come here to make dua to you. What do they want so badly that they came here to make dua for it? They'll say, Ya Allah, they're asking you to forgive them. They're asking you to have mercy upon them. And Allah Azza wa Jal will say, I will want you to all bear witness that on this day I've forgiven all of them. All of their minor sins, I have wiped it clean on this day. And the angels may even come forward and say, there's one amongst them, he is a fasiq, he's rebellious, he's a sinner. He didn't even plan to come here on this day. He just happened to get here somehow. Allah Azza wa Jal will say, I have forgiven him too. That's the greatness of this place in this day. After this day, the Prophet ﷺ stood on Jabal al-Rahmah, the mountain of mercy, those big pile of rocks on Arafah, and he told all of his companions, come close, come very close, because I have something important to tell you. I don't think we listen to this very properly most of the time, because this was the last advice of the Prophet ﷺ to this whole ummah. And what was that advice? The farewell sermon. The farewell sermon is a synopsis of Islam. It's what Islam is all about. This is the heart of our deen is within these sentences. But this was so important that the Prophet ﷺ made sure he set people out through the crowd to continue to convey the message, repeat what you hear me saying. And then he started it by saying, pay close attention to my words, because I don't know if I will be with you again on this day, at this place after this year. He thought his life was coming to an end because Jibreel alayhi salam was coming very frequently. He felt that this might be it for me. This might be the last time I have to tell all of you something in one place, so listen to me. Then after every few sentences, he would look at those who are gathered in front of him and he would say, you're going to be questioned about me one day. What are you going to say? When Allah questions you about me, what are you going to tell Allah? And they all responded by saying, we will bear witness that you conveyed the message of Allah to us. You did qum fa'andhir to us, and you gave us the best nasiha, the best advice. And he would say a few more things, ask the same question, get the same response. But then he would say what would become one of the most weighty things that would ever come out of his mouth, besides telling us to worship Allah. One of the most weighty things that he would give to this ummah would be the last thing he would say. He looked at this ummah and he said, those who are here today, convey this message to those that are not here. Subhanallah. Those who are here today, convey this message to those that are not here. For truly it may be that the person whom you convey the message to may understand it better than you. I don't think we realize what happened. No, I really don't. I really think we've lost the understanding that our izzah was given to us on this day. This is the day where the Prophet ﷺ did something unprecedented. No prophet had done this. No messenger had done this. Because Allah says about the other nations in Surah Al-Bayyinah that they were only commanded to worship Allah, make the deen pure for Him, aqim as-salah, and establish the salah, pay the zakah, وَذَلِقُ الدِّينُ الْقَيِّمَةِ. This was the right way for them. Wait for the next messenger to come. But the Prophet ﷺ understood he was Khatam al-Nabiyeen. I'm it. There's no more coming until the day of judgment. And there's going to be a lot of people that are going to come until that day. So who now is going to do the job of conveying the message of Allah to humanity? He said, you will. This is your task now. He handed that torch to this ummah that made us kuntum khayran ummatan ukhrijat lin-nas. That made us kuntum khayra ummatan ukhrijat lin-nas. Ta'muruna bil-ma'ruf wa tanhauna 'anil munkar wa tu'minuna billah. It's not just because you say la ilaha illallah makes you the best nation. If you're not out there trying to better the society you live in, tell other people to worship Allah like you worship Him, then you're just waiting to die. That's it. You might as well dig your grave now and just lay down in it and wait for the angel of death to come find you. Because you're not doing anyone any good, so just go benefit yourself. The Prophet ﷺ said, you have a job to do now. And that job is my job. The job that I did, you do it. Because I'm not going to be here anymore. I don't think we grasp that. This is what made this nation the nation that will be marched in front of everyone on the Day of Judgment. Izzah, honor, dignity given to this nation. The nation that will become a witness over every other nation. We will witness over every other nation. When Nuh alayhi salam is asked by Allah, Ya Nuh, did you convey your message? Nuh will say, yes, I conveyed my message. Allah will ask Nuh's people, did any messenger come to you? They will say, no, nobody. Nobody came to us. We didn't have nobody come to us. Allah will say, Ya Nuh, do you have a witness? Do you have someone who will say you did your job that is trustworthy? He will say, go to Muhammad and the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They bear witness of me. And we will say, yes, Nuh did his job because we read of him. We know of him. Did even the messengers that we didn't know of, did they do their job? Yes, we know they did their job because Allah azza wa jal commands us to believe in all of them with no distinction amongst them. We will be witnesses for them, no problem. This is the greatness of this ummah. This is the ummah that follows the man for whom no one will be able to get the Day of Judgment to start. We will be standing there 50,000 years so frustrated that we don't care whether we go to Jannah or Nar. Just somebody tell Allah to start this day. We go to Adam alayhi salam. Adam says, I can't. I disobeyed my Rabb. Nuh, I can't. I use my dua on my people. Ibrahim, I can't. I lied. Musa, I killed the man. Isa, are you joking? They worship me like I was Allah. Go to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and it will be because of the request of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam that the Day of Judgment will convince. It will be because of his dua when he says, Ummati, Ummati, my nation, forgive them. That Allah will forgive us for all the riffraff that we have done in our lives. And it will be the person, we follow the person to whom when all of us have been granted Jannah, insha'Allah ta'ala, say thumma ameen, 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 when we're granted Jannah, we're standing outside the gates of Jannah, we're knocking, all of us, we're standing in front of the eight gates, we're knocking, let me in, I want to see my house, and the angel keeps telling us, I can't let you in, you're not allowed, this door does not open for you, Adam, I can't let you in, Musa, I can't let you in, Isa, I can't let you in. It won't be until our beloved messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam comes and knocks on that door and the angel says, who is it? Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The angel will say, by Allah, I was commanded to open this door for no one but you. But for you. Do we convey this message to the world anymore? Do they know this? No, they don't. Because we keep it contained within these walls. We need to wake up. We need to wake up before we end up living in a place where we're not welcomed anymore. Before we end up waking up in a place where we're not welcome and we cannot blame anyone but us because we have not done our job. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر لي ولكم فاستغفره إنه الغفور الرحيم. بسم الله والحمد لله. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين والذين تابعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد. Lastly, brothers and sisters, I know I'm being very rough with you today, but sometimes we need it, and I'm allowed because I got to leave and you can't kick me out. MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. I'm leaving anyway, but I want to give you the last and final story, which is the saddest story of my life, even though I wasn't there. And if it's not the saddest story of all of your lives, then your iman is in jeopardy. Wallahi, your iman is in trouble. This is the life of the last day of the greatest man who ever walked the face of this earth. But before that, I want to remind you of something really quickly. I almost forgot it, the last story. After the Prophet ﷺ said these beautiful words of passing this message on to humanity, do you know how important this was to Allah? Do you know how important these words of conveying the message was to Allah? That the Prophet ﷺ raised his hands to the heavens and he said, O Allah, bear witness. O Allah, bear witness. O Allah, bear witness. I have conveyed the message. I did my job. I'm done. I'm done. You know what Allah Azza wa Jalla responded by saying? Al-yawm akmaltu lakum dinukum. This day I have perfected your religion for you. I have completed my ni'mah upon you and have chosen for you Islam as your deen. Allah completed His final revelation to humanity. Excuse me, His final way of life to humanity. He completed His final way of life to humanity upon the statement of the Prophet ﷺ to continue to convey the message. Allah completed His deen on our shoulders. On the shoulders of this ummah, and we have dropped it by the wayside. Something that was placed on our shoulders as an izzah, we have placed it on the ground, and we have picked up this dunya, and we've placed that on our shoulders. That's why we are humiliated everywhere we go. Because we have left our source of honor behind us, and have picked up that which will humiliate us. It will. This dunya does nothing but humiliate. It honors no one. We forget to understand that this dunya does not honor anyone. It only humiliates people. The only people whom it honors are people who put it in its proper place and they put deen on top of it. Then it will become honored. But when you give dunya a place of prominence in your life, it will humiliate you. It's guaranteed. So let's fast forward to the last day of the life of the Prophet ﷺ and finish in these two moments. He sallallahu alayhi wasallam was sick. And he was laying his head on the chest of Aisha. Radiallahu anha wa radaha, the person whom he loved the most in this life. Only a few days had passed since Allah Azza wa Jal said the last thing He will ever say to humanity. Only a few days had passed since Allah said the last and final thing He will ever say to human beings and jinn. وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمٍ تُرْجَعُونَ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. And remember and fear a day. Have taqwa of the day on which you will return to Allah. And no one on that day will be dealt with unjustly. This is the last thing that Allah Azza wa Jal will ever say to any of us. If you want to know what the last thing Allah will say, go to Surah Al-Baqarah. I think it is verse 186, I believe, inshallah. 185, 186 is the last thing Allah will ever say to you. But after this, the Prophet ﷺ got sick. And he was laying his head on the chest of Aisha radiallahu anha. He was too sick to even get up, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He could not even lift his head barely. He couldn't even barely speak. He was looking at a miswak stick, and Aisha radiallahu anha asked him, "Do you want it?" And he nodded in the affirmative. So she softened it with her own saliva, and her saliva became the last thing our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam ever tasted in this life. That's a woman whom was given extreme honor by Allah azza wa jal. Her saliva was the last thing he ever tasted in this life sallallahu alaihi wasallam. After that, something happened that Aisha wasn't privy to at the moment. The angel of death walked into the room. The angel of death came into the room. Now for us, when we see the angel of death, the only thing he will say is soul, either soul khabitha, come out, or good and pure soul, come out. That's it. And our soul will respond. That's it. But for the prophets and messengers, it's a different status, especially for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The angel of death had to come ask for permission to take the beautiful soul of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And before that, he was shown his house in Jannah. As the Prophet ﷺ said, every prophet and messenger is shown their place in Jannah before their death. So Aisha said she saw him looking up at the ceiling and began to smile. He was being shown his place in Jannah. We can't imagine our house in Jannah. We can't even imagine a tree in Jannah, much less the property of Ar-Rasul ﷺ, the most honored property in Jannah. He's being showed this. And then the angel of death says to him, "You can either go here, this is your home, you can go. Or Allah Azza wa Jal can heal you and you can recover from this illness." And he told this ummah two things. First of all, he said, "As-salah, as-salah, as-salah." Don't forget your connection with Allah. This is what makes you Muslim. The difference between us and them is our salah. That's it. That's what differentiates us. Then Aisha radiallahu anha said she saw him looking up and saying, "Allahumma rafiq al-a'la. Allahumma rafiq al-a'la." O Allah, the companion upon Most High. O Allah, the companion upon Most High. She realized, she said, "I realized that the angel of death was here and he wasn't choosing us. He wasn't choosing us. He was choosing to go." And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left on that day. His blessed soul was taken and transported into the highest ranks of Jannah that exist. And that became the most sad day for this ummah. Seriously. The companion said that on that day we checked our hearts. And our hearts had changed. Our hearts weren't the same anymore. It was said about them that they were like sheep on a cold winter's night whose shepherd had left them. They did not even know where to go. Umar, who was the best man after the prophets and messengers, who would have been a prophet if there were going to be another prophet. Umar lost it on that day and said, if any of you says Muhammad is dead, I'll kill you myself. Abu Bakr had to console him and he sat down. But there was a woman on that day whom put everything into perspective for us. And this is how we finish. Forgive me for going over for 5 minutes. She put everything into perspective for us. She said, she was crying. Her name was Ayman. Radiallahu anha wa radaha. If you don't know about Ayman, you gotta go way, 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 way back in the seerah. She's the woman whom Amina, the mother of the Prophet, entrusted him to upon her demise. And she became his mother. If you want to know how a mother should be treated, look at how the Prophet ﷺ treated Ayman. He treated her like a mother. He called her Ummi, my mother, after my mother. She lived to see everything in his life, ﷺ. She lived to see him die and she cried. Who wouldn't? Who wouldn't? But Abu Bakr and Umar came and said, Ya Ayman, what the Prophet ﷺ has been given in death is better than what he had in life. He suffered so much for us. For us. For us. He didn't suffer for himself, ﷺ. He suffered for us and for them out there. He suffered for those people who don't know the truth. She said, I'm not crying because of his death. I'm crying because the wahi from Allah has stopped. I'm crying because our Lord will not speak to us anymore. That the next time we hear from our Rabb will be the day we stand in front of him. And Abu Bakr and Umar, they understood that. But they understood something about it that we've forgotten. They understood that yes, maybe Allah has stopped speaking to humanity. But that's only because he said everything he needed to say. It's collected for us. It's contained for us in the book of Allah and in the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. But we have to say one thing about them. Alhamdulillah, they're not like us. Alhamdulillah, that the companions were not like us. Because if they did what we do, if they did what we do, wallahi, if any of us would be Muslim. This is why if you abuse one single companion, one of them, if you abuse one of them, you have no deen. You have stepped completely out of Islam. Because it is because of them that you know deen. So how dare you say anything negative about any of these great men and women? They did their job and legacy is there. Their legacy is clear for all of us to see. They did their job and people after them did their job so that we could be here today. What about the next generation? Who's doing the job for them? Who's doing the job for these ignorant people who don't know Allah? They don't know Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They're only feeding fueled information what they've gotten from the shaitan and the media and everything else. No wonder they hate you because they only hear negative of you and you don't do anything to counterbalance that. You don't do anything to check it and you don't even go out there and try to show them Islam through our actions, through our dealings, through our business, through our akhlaq, through our adab, everything. We need to wake up, brothers. And sisters, if there are any with us, please, we have to wake up to the fact that we have a job to do. I don't care if you're a doctor, I don't care if you're a dentist, I don't care if you're a taxi driver, I don't care if you clean the streets of Bradford. You have a responsibility of qum fa'andir, of getting up off of your behinds and going out there and sharing Islam with the world. And tonight, inshallah ta'ala, we will expound upon this principle, how you can go about sharing this beautiful message and some of the usul of this idea, some of the roots of this idea of da'wah, inshallah. ربنا آتينا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار اللهم اغفر لي ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على قوم الكافرين سبحانك ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين وأقيم الصلاة